Dear speakers, dear guests, I would like to start our conference and this roundtable, and we have a very interesting topic today. We have a little bit more time than we expected originally, so everybody will have a chance to speak. It is an interesting topic indeed. It is very topical and urgent for our country, because we have very unusual ideas. I have flown in today from our internal strategic session, where we define the new products, and the corporate venturing was actually number one after we were discussing the results. There are not so many companies on the market that are active in this area. So as it is today, this topic is really of great interest. The president said that we will set up 25 more million jobs, and then they faced a sudden problem. In order to make high efficiency jobs, you have to fire a lot of people, and then they will have more jobs. But there will be no political, there is no political will to fire people, because the target is stability. So upgrading and modernization is getting complicated by important social limitations that are inevitable. There are almost no new jobs being created in the country, and the existing jobs, they will be hard to lose, In fact, this is happening world over. If you look at the major corporations, their role in setting up new jobs is actually dubious. They have not been setting up new jobs for quite a while, so they have an interest to have their core business very efficient, using new technologies, new processes. So the companies are getting optimized, so they do have to fire people. There are redundancies. So strategic sustainability of companies, they are actually getting people redundant. So many country leaders today, in their discussions, they're arriving to a conclusion that the main source for an economic growth is actually entrepreneurship. And this is being confirmed. We can see this is true. If you look at the other countries, we see where there's active development of entrepreneurship, there's sustainable growth. And the issue is not only that there's new ideas emerging in the companies. The point is there's contradiction. The bigger corporations, they do have an interest in their sustainable core business, and they do have to develop by increasing the efficiency of the operations. So eventually, they're actually firing people. So corporate venturing started to develop in the 70s. If you remember the most well-known case with Exxon case, that they have set up the first corporate venture fund in the 90s, and dozens of major corporations set up something similar. And there were two major targets. The first one, to support a long-term sustainable growth of the business, looking for new ideas for long-term survival. And secondly, bringing in new innovation activities by the inflow of external new ideas and incorporating those new ideas. So this is not anything very new. But as we have problems with economic growth right now in Russia, and the growth, there's only two ways to get this growth, either increase the efficiency or increase the jobs, and the number of jobs. Or the best way is to do that simultaneously, and there's no other way, there's no third way. So corporate venturing could be the driver for creating new jobs, as our president, premier are expecting, so that would result in their growth. I will pass the floor to Dmitry Pyson. I will make a short overview. Thank you very much, dear colleagues. I would just outline a list of issues that we would discuss today, different angles. So we can see that at this table you have a larger corporations representative, both domestic and foreign, and reps of some active Skolkovo startups who do work together with larger corporations, and then Roscosmos representative, for example. So it would be interesting getting a multifaceted overview vertically integrated industries, including startups, small and medium enterprises, who are trying to contribute into the innovation development, find their place in the economy. So the main ideas, the list of ideas that we should be reviewing here. First, we understand the problem of coordination of larger companies with smaller companies, or vertical integrated companies with startups, or innovative companies would be of any interest to the vertical integrated companies like space, defense, machine building. That's where the market is defined by some oligopolic major companies' concerns. So where the market is actually vertically integrated, so there's nothing like an ideal competitive case, and there's no competitive products that would allow to immediately penetrate the market. In the horizontal industries, it will be easier because of these companies. It's easier for them to find their place and to compete. So there's 10,000 companies entering, 1,000 remains, 100 remains, then 10 are getting to the top. In the vertically integrated companies, smaller companies will have to find their place in the value chains and the production chains, in the cooperation structures, in order to be successful and to contribute into the development of the certain industries, both domestically and internationally. So the issues are, what is the actual role of small and medium enterprises in the stronger vertical integrated companies oriented for the government orders for longer life cycles? So we're talking about optimization of innovations. The majors are not always interested in any breakthrough development. They're in fact interested more in stabilization and keeping the business as usual. So let's see how the small companies could contribute here, how could they play in. And the second thing is the continuous replenishment of the competitive basis. So in the vertically complex industries where there's already an established set of relationship, there's oligopolistic or monopolistic situation, and the trend is to set up actually syndicates and cartels, some formal or informal agreements, and the market is actually getting less and less like a market, competitive market. It's getting to be a field of mutual agreements, stronger government-to-business agreements. So then the emergence of smaller companies, smaller businesses, could bring into leavening of the situation, like SpaceX Musk in the US, where the market has been split up for a long while for space launches. There's new players there, and the landscape is getting to be different. So there are other roles. So I'd like to hear that. What could be the roles of smaller companies in the vertically integrated major companies? The next is the participation of smaller companies in cooperation chains, whether there's real economic motivation for the major companies to attract SMEs to implement certain orders, to outsource some jobs, or would they be fully integrating those so that they will be having this in-house, not outsourcing anything, or would there be any tools of compelling to bring the innovations in? So Russia is peddling this. Other countries have similar problems. We cannot say that they're being forced, but strongly recommended involvement of SMEs into majors' activities. So we'll see whether there's be a natural coordination between smallers and big and majors, or the role of the government will stay like a pusher and puller. So let's see if there are any common universal guidelines where the majors would be interested in SMEs, like components, IT, software, consulting, componentry. So there should be a vision. There should be a vision where SMEs could find their place in doing business with the majors. Well, it so happens we're so, in a certain degree, we're all here space people. So it is actual that there's state programs, and most of the money for the civilian space programs, they go through this one structure, government structure. So technology of forming up, they have to do with so-called leading companies that are getting state orders, and then they would eventually attract other companies, including SMEs. So lately we see some of the techniques which make it easier for the SMEs to get involved in those orders, big orders, in implementing the space program. So there's a reduced requirements for the licensing, and we're grateful to Roscosmos so that there's progress on that. There's a special preferential treatment, at least for Skolkovo residents. But as for the support of the SMEs, the potential of the federal programs is still there. So there's still capacity for new approaches that could be implemented. And now we're talking about new space program 1625 for the next decade. So within that framework, this is the time to discuss new approaches, organizational structures, and their specialized framework world, like the federal target program, when they have personnel and training and staffing program, so that potential executors will do that, that the colleges and universities involvement, so that certain program will be allocated to a special program within a university or college. We could be talking about fixing a certain portions of SMEs within cooperation for dedicated events. That's the way they do it in the USA. When they have, in the beginning, they have defined the share of the funding to go to cooperation with universities and colleges, to SMEs, and there's this long issue of, well, they've been talking and talking about that, possibility of financing educational programs so that personnel are trained originally in a dedicated way to match the federal development programs. Again, this issue, it's coming back again and again, but the Ministry of Economic Development and the Finance Ministry is still sticking to the industry management techniques. So they're still talking that the personnel training has to go to respective ministries. So we should be probably discussing this again. And the issue number three is our favorite one for our space cluster. We're talking about this DARP, the DARP program for the strategic research, to follow this American DARP model. So within that program, certain part of the budget would be dedicated to special programs with no immediate results expected, with certain tendering, not within the traditional companies of the industry, but outside of that cluster. So we need that in our program. Okay, this was very short. What are we going to talk to? Of course, there will be more issues. You are free to come up with more issues. But this is a good opportunity to use this chance when we're all here. Thank you. Well, I suggest we give the floor to Dmitry, and I will take part in that discussion, because the role of moderator, because he should stay with Dmitry, because he knows all the participants here at this table, and he was planning the session. Is that okay with you? And I will take part in the discussion, so that I have something to say. Okay, don't view that as a coup d'etat. Okay. Originally, we plan to ask our guests here to speak sector by sector, let's say with the public or the government sector, ask the Roscosmos Space Agency and their Department of Strategic Planning. Let's ask Mr. Simonov how he sees the cooperation between government majors and SMEs. And what's the vision of the future? Please, please. Mr. Simonov from Roscosmos. My apologies first, because I'm coming from a different department, and we have to do with this vertical, as Dmitry said, vertically integrated business in this rocket and missile industry. I am from the Department of Strategic Planning. Let me try and answer those questions with our strategic vision for the industry. development and the possibility of development of innovative activities. In general, Roscosmos is working on a concept to set up a system supporting innovative activities in the industry, and we're trying to review the whole scope that could be implemented. That could include venturing, and some venturing within the corporation, actually, and also setting up an in-house venture system within our industry, which would support the initiatives of that kind. We're actively working with the venture foundations that do have experience working with NASA and the European Space Agency, with Russian majors, in trying to understand. It is not a transparent issue that has to do with in-house corporate venture funds, foundations. In the Ministry for Economic Development, in the Ministry of Industry, there's certain their own vision of their own, which would allegedly encourage, let me use that word, the establishment of corporate venture funds, foundations, within the budgets of the budget companies that do have more than 50% of government ownership. I will start out by stating that in the companies within Roscosmos, the experience of their cooperation with different development institutions is not satisfactory as it is today, because there are both in-house corporate issues and there are issues of setting up this coordination, because there are very tough requirements coming from those development institutions for the projects declared. So out of the companies that have received at least certain progress, their experience of working together with development institutions, there's only 6 or 7 of those in our industry. Problem number two that should be seriously regarded at this stage is everything that has to do with the innovative belt of SMEs around our majors. Well, I have to admit, the story of the history of those activities is not one of great success, because those SMEs around the majors, historically, they were their own subsidiaries, and I mean both administration and financial support. That is not really a market situation. So their market behavior is not what was expected when they were set up. They had been set up for specific projects, and the projects have been implemented for the benefit of the mother companies. So the further market promotion of those SMEs is not one of any success story. What about attempts of compelling into innovation? That's a word in fashion. My vision is that you cannot say those about 10. It's now about 10 that are now in the list of companies that have been compelled to set up their innovative development programs. We cannot say that there's any productive result. The documents have been formed, but the internal management, they do not see any tool in their document. The management believes that, okay, the document is okay, it was properly compiled, and they could be in line with the production program of that company, but they are not in the mainstream of setting up a innovative development for that company. Even though those strategic papers, they do exist in the, at the company's level. As for the dedicated personnel training and education. There's two sides to that. Despite the innovative character of the industry, the space industry, we have to admit it is not until the best students will go to the industry there will not be any breakthroughs. So this is a multi-criteria definition. It has to do with many issues that have to be resolved. For Roscosmos, we understand the major prospects, and our management are closely monitoring that. Like, there was a meeting recently with the Ministry for Education and the leaders of main colleges and universities, and the issues have been discussed. So we expect that the nearest future there will be something like an agreement, interdepartmental agreement between the agencies. So there will be a vision on behalf of the educational departments in the government, and also from the side of Roscosmos. They do have an interest in attracting new talents. So we will be producing this document. We'll be making it public. Next, the planning system and defining the targets. There's quite a few issues. Roscosmos and the research institution for the machine building, they're working on a set of documents which would be part of the federal target development program, so that there's a list of operations stated and the link of target, tasks and means. Dmitry also mentioned that within the federal space program and the part of that of R&D, framework R&D, it does have to do, it is seriously linked with those two-way traffic of setting up the defining the requirements of the companies in innovations and services and the respective capabilities and capacities of the market to meet those requirements, and also to be able to submit their own capabilities and possibilities, what they can offer. We understand that within the industry there are no special dedicated structures. The companies, and Dmitry was right in stating that, it just so happened since Soviet Union times, the companies are very specific for everything to be developed in-house. So it's more or less 100% in-house. So inter-corporate cooperation between the majors is not built in a very rational way, let alone the SMEs coordination. So this is a major issue. Another issue, and Roscosmos does admit that, we'll be trying to settle that in the near future. Setting up the in-house, in the industry development institutions. Yesterday we had this panel discussion. Let's see, one of the business incubators reps, he asked a very trivial question. There's an idea, you have to implement it in hardware. So whenever they go, there's a big issue, you need high-tech equipment. So just an example, from idea to hardware, long way. So like the Center for the Transfer of Technologies and the Center for Collective Usage of Equipment, there's a capacity to set it up in a distributed virtual mode, so that later on there'll be structures like legal entities that could be do that. Well, we realize we're in the beginning of a long way, but we are optimistic. We will be tackling those problems in an active way, and we hope there will be a two-way traffic between business and us as a federal agency. There is an understanding that there's certainly a need for initiatives from both ways, because a government clerk sitting in his office doesn't see the whole picture, and it's hard to take decisions. So we are open to any discussions and any decisions we will take. They will be targeting to work not despite the difficulties, but thanks to benefits. I'll give you an example. Some 6 months ago, we started it and we finished it in May, working on the document called the Basics of the Government Policies in Space Activities. It is a complex document. It's a pioneering document. It was hard to actually formulate it, but it was the first experience when Roscosmos contacted directly the interested parties in the area, in the industry, contacted the businessmen and entrepreneurs in the related areas. And it was not just, and it was a very hard discussion, but that was the first try, and the first try is not always successful. But we hope for success. We believe those activities within this trilateral, like development, design, construction, and operation, there is capacity for involving SMEs. Because it's a question of the so-called last mile. And the companies that are actually building the products, operations, or services using our space. Developed results, Roscosmos can actually contribute in setting up a normal market for space products. Thank you for your attention. Thank you so much. Any of the participants here has any questions to Roscosmos that could be asked right away? Okay, we'll move on. I suggest we'll jump over the next stage. We will leave the conversation with the major companies. We'll leave it for later. But let's talk with startups now, companies that are trying to find their missions here in Skolkovo and other applications. Let's see what are the possible solutions. We have reps here from different companies. We have the Skolkovo reps for the space cluster. So let's ask our colleague here, what are the ideas in the area? Good day. Let me start with a comment, and that was Pavel Bulat. When we talk about hardware, our company, just some 3 weeks ago, in the Chamber of Commerce of St. Petersburg, where we had a conference of the local colleges and universities and the Ministry for Education. And there was a figure voiced that the successful startups within the colleges, 98% is IT and communications. The only reason being that you don't produce anything in hardware, you can just go and buy the components on the market. So I'm telling this story to everybody. We're trying a simple electromechanical bench here in Skolkovo, and the nearest place we could actually implement it in hardware was Krasnoyarsk in Siberia. So as it is today for SMEs, we have lost 100% lost the capacity to actually implement anything in iron, in hardware, even if you have money. When we're talking to Skolkovo Technopark, Skolkovo Foundation, we found out that there'll be only three companies involved for a mechanical processing or assembly or coating. 30,000 square meters, only three companies. So it is still, there's still no provision in Skolkovo for their collectively available workshops, mechanical workshops, demonstration shops, vibration benches. The first thing that has to be done for a SME company, something that was covered yesterday by Sogdeev, you have to come with your hand a written drawing and to have it implemented in hardware for a reasonable amount of money. And funny enough, in the 90s, early 2000, in St. Petersburg, that was much more readily available. And I had my own mechanical plant that was offering those services. But then there were oil companies killing everything, and then the larger corporations eating up all of that independent industries. other things that startup companies are facing. I have, I'm dealing with innovation since 96, especially in petrochemicals. The problems are still there, they haven't changed much, but what has changed is the economic environment. As it is today for an SME company, the only source of subsistence is the grants of the Bortnik Foundation. Actually, there's no other sources of financing. The money from the Ministry of Education go to directly to colleges, universities. There's substantial amounts, and there are good fleets of machines and equipment, but they live a life of their own. They have to write their articles, and they will have a response R&D, and that's what they call commercialization. So if a SME, an innovative SME comes to college, they are regarded first of all as an investor, but if they're looking for an order to be fulfilled, they view it as an extra user of their money, which is not too much. The other money which goes through the defense ministry and the Russian technologies, they are channeled through major government corporations, and we do have some lucky experience. And I have successfully defended one project with Rosnano, and the company did get a government contract from the Ministry of Industry to design a video chip with Elvis and the Russian television institution.
I can tell you. Between 15 and 35% went for development. The rest goes to the structure. So where the money go? So if we speak about developing a venture departments in Skolko, for instance, then the situation bumps into subjective things. So this is a picture from the exhibition. On one day, I managed to visiting two corporations, the aviation and space companies. During the lunchtime, people are coming from the offices and start talking. What about how they will spend next weekend in their country house? Just not the spent past weekend, but the next one. So they are keeping the offices for 20 years, and they were. Young, we are speaking about the deputy of innovations and asking why don't you fund the universities? And the answer is how can I give this money because I have the workload for 55% only, and I cannot dismiss these people, and the number of people of R&D is not adequate, and I cannot quit this. So if I transfer them to Skolkovo, the economics is much better. The tax shelter is better. Just I'm shaving off about 30% from this loaf, and nobody is willing to quit the company because they're having guaranteed wages. And they will keep working for extra 20 years before retire. And if they quit and go to Skolkovo, and this is a grant system. One grant expires, next one doesn't come, and they are suspended. And the young people don't want to quit the company. No sound. Well, I was talking a very hot topic, apparently, so my mic refuses to work. So the young people don't want to quit because they want to share experience from the experienced people. So the only way out is setting up the big independent companies, which will invite the experts, giving the good bonuses and good paychecks. And in this manner, I just outlined two major issues, the staffing and the access to funding at the current stage. But these are not the only issues. It's worth mentioning that many people don't understand what to do. There are many topics, and traditionally, all the federal special purpose programs, they are formulated from underneath, from bottom up. And there are many proposals, 95-99% are lying in the areas where it's not possible to get a commercial feedback. And everybody understand if we speak about Skolkovo Roscosmos, the vertical integrated program, which was formulated on top, which was sent for the small business. And I think just developing some units, some nodes, developing just cheap carrier with expelling system of fuel delivery to stay away from compressor systems, or just lightweight transmission, or engines combined with various fuel cells, thermodynamic cycle, etc., and so on. But this program should be covering several years. Not quite understand how it will be funded. It's very difficult to think how it can be set up. And who will be the authors, developers of the program? And if there's no such program, then we will find the situation as Rosnano is doing, just many sporadic things. But Mr. Chubais is telling that this is not the profit, this is just idea that should be behind. Maybe this is right, but it was not formulated at the very onset of Rosnano. Life cycle. So, as an example, not from the aerospace industry, what was published recently, the parliament hearings, the interceptors, MiG-31, 91, position of equipment is manufactured not on the companies reporting to aerospace industry. This is a no-brainer. These things can be developed and produced in companies, specialized companies. So if you have a idea of how who's doing the dies, no-brainer. You know, any company can do it, not necessarily reporting to the Minister of Defense. Thank you very much. You just provide us with a comprehensive standpoint. We have two representatives from Skolkovo, reps from the startup, Dmitry Tsetlin, having the big experience on developing startups. What can you tell us about SME interaction with the big boys? I have an experience in a startup, and my first startup was is dated back to 1989 in the USSR. And I'm dealing with innovations. I was working in Israel last 4 years. I'm working in Russia. I think the potential is great. There's just vast pastures to graze on. And I can repeat myself by saying that there's a will of the government and preconditions, the human capital and Skolkovo, with which I'm working from the very onset for about 3 years. Plus, I'm teaching the innovative entrepreneurship and transfer technologies in the Institute of Construction. So I know this situation from all the sides. And we're working successfully with Skolkovo for about 18 months. 1.5 years. I'm a consultant and as an entrepreneur. And through our company, about 30 residents of Skolkovo went through. We helped them to set up nominations to get status. I was born in Samara, and I'm quite familiar with the aerospace industry. I was working in Kuznetsov. We even assigned a Skolkovo resident. So you can approach this issue from various sides. I'm having a top view for the issue. From my standpoint, where I'm just teaching students, there are three sources of innovations: innovative entrepreneurship, the control of R&D in big companies and universities, and transfer technologies. So these are the three cornerstones around which everything rotates. Dealing with the entrepreneurship and venture, I think this is closely the venture thing. The entrepreneurs can be just commercial people by definition, doing some new or entrepreneurs inside the corporations or the scientists in the universities. For each of them, for each case, these are different cases. We cannot compare them. And for them, develop they have different models of behavior and setting up the new SME. Speaking of the aerospace industry. This is a more or less stable area, and this is very difficult to take out entrepreneur from the company. My colleague said that people don't want to quit. They are thinking about tomorrow. And says progress, which exists for about 55 years and will exist another 55 years to leave it and to start new business is a psychological issue. To leave the staff of about 20,000 people and become all alone in the field. You know, this is not an easy issue, a solution to take. And so one has to teach it, to support. So from this standpoint, Skolko is an ideal vehicle to provide a support to entrepreneurs. And the cluster of aerospace technologies is coping with the issue. So these 100 residents, which appeared from the aerospace industry in Russia. This is the basis of the entrepreneurship, the healthy basis on which everything will start growing. There are methods to support, and I think this is how the whole thing works. The second issue, the control of R&D programs. There are innovative programs which are artificial, natural, call them any name. I'm meeting Shadrin and Ministry of Economic Development. I know how they exist. I'm providing consulting services to the Central Engineering Bureau, and I know how this works. The aerospace industry, by definition, and R&D takes much share, and lots of money spent on improving the R&D, and the space companies don't want to take this budget outside because they have to support their own staff, which is involved in the R&D, and there is some conflict of interest. And the major thing from the standpoint of entrepreneurs and the people who are involved into this activity to support the harmony in the system. And the, over the last 2 years, I see the situation is dramatically changing. It's discussed, the issue of the venture funds is discussed, but at least it's debatable. There's some motion underway. This is a long-term process. So we have to support the pace and go on. Speaking of the corporate venture funds and the venture funds as a whole, the venture investors are special people who are supporting special entrepreneurs. And in the center of the thing, the innovative innovator sense. So to set up a venture fund for the sake of setting up, this doesn't make any sense. The funds are associated with people who are capable of growing the business within the next 5 years out of $50 million. These businesses and these people in the aerospace industry, which are capable of doing that for $50 million worth within the next 5 years, this is the major issue. How many people we can find and how many funds are necessary? This is how I address this issue. On the other hand, there are SME, small businesses, which during the next 5 years are capable of developing business $5 million worth. This is a different scale of magnitude and different tasks. In America, this thing is resolved by Small Business Administration. There is a R&D share of a R&D budget. 20% goes to fund these companies. This is obligatory. This facilitates involving these small companies into the process. So my estimate of the process is positive, but we have to move in this direction and speak about it more often to bring this issue up, finding solutions, and the result will follow. Thank you. So I just want to put into the minutes of the meeting that Mr. Catlin doesn't see any issues with vertical corporations. I'm staying on friendly terms with the big companies. The president was microphone, please. Microphone. Yeah, yeah. Well, this is realistic. I'm just I'm dead serious. Vertical integrated structures. There's a person who has problems, Vadim Khomenko, another representative of Skolkovo. Other people are happy, and you are the one who is the warrior. Well, first of all, I would like to join Dmitry Moiseevich that Skolkovo is the best. The second thing, I'm grateful for Dmitry Borisovich, with whom we're working in good, enjoying a good relation. Working for, he invited me to take part in this forum. So why for Skolkovo is the best? When we started with working with venture funds. So we had a talk. And I understood that this is not for us. This is not my cup of tea. And I am joining Dmitry Moiseevich because this is not almost everybody. Taking the Roscosmos, there will be three funds. And in order to do that, to set up fund, what is good about Skolkovo? So we came down here. Just, you know, money is free of charge. They were given. These are grants. Grants are the best, which can exist in the aerospace industry today, because we are doing lots of research and the projects, innovative projects, especially in the aerospace cluster, and it was discussed yesterday and today. These are not innovative projects. These are innovation, innovative projects. Without investment, we cannot speak anything about it, and there is no investment. So far, there's no progress. But the idea itself of Skolkovo and the approach that we covered over the last year, I had 40 years in aerospace industry, and 1 year in Skolkovo is almost the same in magnitude for my previous 40-year experience. And I'm echoing what Dmitry Borisovich said. A couple of words about my company, Dipcom company, one of the big players in the aerospace cluster. We're supporting four companies here, three companies are developing the leader technologies, and one is involved in microchip and radio electronics. On top of that, when we are working, which was not mentioned by previous representatives, I'm glad that Dmitry Borisovich is supporting it. So when they exchange synergy, yeah, I was looking for the word. So synergetic effect. There are three groups of companies in the cluster. The first one is Scanex, Dauria, and Tikom is the third. Each of these groups supporting several projects. And we have a synergy effect in Dauria. We help them to enter the aerospace market to win the tender for $10 million, and they got money from Goskopnana, and we are helping them to develop the Skolkovo satellite, which is being developed now. And we are ready to start making micro satellites of innovative type. Next step, we are planning to start working with another company in the power sector on the electronic control unit. Yesterday, we had a very good talk and about the government-private partnership. This is the first time that I'm just touching on this term, and there's lots of potential about it. It's composed of two partners, and we're speaking about the Skolkovo and the Roscosmos enterprises. This is the work of the fund and the work of Roscosmos, how they help each other alongside. And there are many issues in this area, and I think that everything goes as it should go. But there are some obvious issues. As today in Russia, we are setting up the innovative structure, which hasn't been existing. So within the shortest time possible, Skolkovo reached pretty good level. And I was attending the parliament hearings when we were involved in the project with the Moscow Power Institute. And we were involved at, as winners of the project to the parliament hearing. The issue was addressed, and Mr. Zhirinovsky was taking floor, and it was said that there was a system in the Soviet Union of control of the scientific development, and it died with the country. So now the system is being developed. It will be developed, of course, but what should be done to develop it as fast as possible? The business mechanism should be set up in Roscosmos first place. So far, this process is not developing as required. Speaking of the survey studies, this is just prompting to cooperation. This is not quite the thing that we want to have. And I used to be involved in it, and I changed my working place for Skolkovo because Skolkovo it's much better. And it's put that the Skolkovo should be among the partners to work, but it's just sitting on the paper. There are two sides of the issue, because Skolkovo is not running up to speed as required. And when we speak about the projects being not only innovative, but also investment, accounting for our experience, and I will just comment on that. We started with four projects. Now we're putting together the exposition for the exhibition in aerospace salon, and we decided not to show anything here because and at the max and maximum we will report about on 15 projects in radio and the control system. So we're developing. We got a good impetus in Skolkovo, and the experience of working with big companies is very helpful. So Dmitry Borisovich was right when he said that under condition when the big corporation are motivated to address their issues, which was said in the opening word. So the small business depends on the innovation. So those companies who went, who survived, they just went through this phase of selection. So NASA experts visited us. They saw our production, and they found technologies of the world class. And they said that the company can be bought. We're staying away from resolving this issue, but these innovative projects can be handed over, but there are no enterprises to provide the support. Big companies are not motivated, and this issue cannot be resolved. There are program, the method, the program was approved by Putin when he was the prime minister, the Committee on High Technologies, and it's put this in the project interaction with Rosnana and Ros and Salko. We're just opening up the site of energy corporation. We read that the corporation energy plans to work with Skolkovo. So they have this survey studies and just telephone, just call this telephone. And we're calling this telephone and we're visiting a center of Khrunichev, made presentations, spoke with Mikhail Alexandrovich, and we're very grateful to him. But speaking of the Khrunichev Center, I can be more specific, as I've already mentioned micro satellites, these CubeSats, the nature of controlled micro satellites which can replace the big satellites. I can tell you that Japan is making the satellite with a weight of 400 kilos, and Russia is making 4-tonner. So we are developing the satellite with weight 70 kilos. So the shaving the cost of $1 billion. The innovations are there, but they are not requested. So incorporating the chain is a very promising the big funds underway, and this mechanism should be streamlined. What we did yesterday, we spoke with Mr. Saveliev on the issue. This, he's the deputy head of the Aerospace Agency. We're speaking about the Research Institute of Roscosmos about joint formulation of the program of innovative activity in aerospace. What we have, we finalizing the putting together the PhD doctoral theses on streamlining the control system of the production, developing the innovative production. There was ideas just to manufacture. We have model 3D, and 3 days later we have this item manufactured out of metal. We don't have the people. There was another talk about the best students, and I was a best student myself. There was a very interesting lecture by Pavel Lusha from the Central Economy School. What competences are required? By the way, it was not mentioned by the Roscosmos representative. The decision was taken on setting up a consortium. I'm about to finish. And when we hire young students, the designer and constructor, software engineer, so they're pretty quick with resolving all the issues, and we are ready to start working. So we anticipate that we will put together a joint proposal with Roscosmos. There was a meeting in the economic development, and it was recommended to set up another meeting of Roscosmos with the Skolkova firms. And our proposal is the following. We are putting together the proposal on streamlining the business mechanisms, and after that we will set up the conditions for business. The main thing is motivation of big companies, which is non-existent, and the survey studies are there, but there's no feedback and the content potential. What's the lack of the this survey studies? There's no motivation, and that's the answer. Thank you. Thank you very much. And the issue here, not well, many issues, but they can be solved. These are operational issues one has to get down, and I'm glad that yesterday and today these meetings will provide an impetus in the right direction. I'm coming back. I'm giving the microphone to Pavel Borisovich, and then we'll give floor to representative of the big companies, whom to blame and what to do. I will do my best to get back to the corporate venture. There's a topic is slightly different from the topic of support of innovation, and I'm quite pleased to hear that back in 1989, I was the general director of the first innovative center in the USSR. In the year 1990, I set up the first incubator, and I used my money, and I had 50 companies in the hotel Zolotoy Kolos with soldering irons, and we didn't quite understand what it was. Despite my visit to America, and I was lectured about venture capital, we didn't succeed in any project, and we didn't know what to expect, and we didn't have an experience. But one company became a Skolkov resident. With their R&D department, their leading representative, process leader in the security system, and in majority of the companies in New York and London, they're using the Russian platform. So there's an Israeli company, and recently the Israeli competition lost in Abu Dhabi, and the five Russian companies won this 10, 20 years passed, and these companies did not enjoy the support of the government. They didn't get the funding, but they are still the leaders. Of course, this is bad example. This is a success story despite all the countermeasures. But this just happened. And it turns up that we have many companies like that. If we look at the listing, there are many companies which succeeded, and we don't know anything about them. I was introduced to potential client, the IT company with capitalization of $300 million, and nobody knows about it. They exist on the market of the U.S. very successfully, doing business in Russia. They know about the technicalities in Russia, but nobody knows that this company has a capitalization of $300 million. A small company, maybe the company was localized in the U.S., but they are still working in Nizhny Novgorod. This is the main supplier of IT, Harris. This is the name of the company. So this company, which is involved in processing video signals, and about 200 programmers are working in Nizhny Novgorod, but the company is localized in the U.S. So the issue is the companies are localized more and more in the U.S. It's good that Skolko was set up, and Skolko is doing best to improve the atmosphere. We had a discussion last year, to be precise. In Dubai, there was a forum on competition, and I'm representing Russia on this issue, on the competition potential. And there was a discussion among the specialists how to improve the competition edge. And a venture capitalist from U.S. Took floor, or better say, American scientists were discussing. And they said, we have an issue with the breakthrough innovation because we are not supported, we are not funded. And this venture capitalist jumped up and said that the science is a commodity. Of course, I will stay away from making such a statement. I don't want to take grudge with anybody. It took me 20 years in this topic, as deep as it's possible, and it's very difficult to imagine. I was the first person in the company in the country who invested into the investment.
Не просто технологии, новые продукты, нужно было искать бизнес-модели, работающие бизнес-модели. Так сегодня это прозрение, наверное, позднее, когда-то до меня дошло, может быть, лет 10 назад, когда я стал заниматься активно стратегическим планированием, 15 даже. Сегодня я вижу, что все чаще это происходит со многими компаниями.
Now I can see that this is happening more often and often. So the problem is not just only the technological perfection which we're looking for, which is quite very important still, but this is one of the processes only. The problem is our bottleneck is an entrepreneur being capable to create value for the end user based on the technology that he had invented or he had purchased. Moreover, the world is changing very fast. Why did this American had a contract? Because I was the first one to tell him innovation is not just a process of creation. Innovation is creation of value for the end user, creating money and knowledge, not just knowledge. Process of creating knowledge is actually science, scientific activity. So when you take this knowledge and convert it into money, this is innovation. So this is entirely different activity. It seems to be very close, very similar, but it's different. So looking for those business models is a very critical area of knowledge that today is in need of any corporation needs that they should grow business models. Step by step, they do spring up with more or less degree of success, different degrees of success. But if you ask me, or ask investment analyst or a company like Gazprom, and they could invest in anything like horse raising, horse breeding, or agriculture, or newspapers, or television, or anything else nothing to do with gas. But they do have a core business that they are losing day to day. And investment analysts say, well, they should be investing in that. What are they doing? That's wrong. So there will always be this contradiction. If you are active in innovation and you set up your corporate venturing, you may be blamed for too much diversification of your business, staying away from your core business. In fact, in many cases, they were right. And they said, just do your core business so that they buy your gas and you grow your gas business and you have profits, but not lose your markets one by one. On the other side, the bigger companies that we have set up here, integrated, they should have dedicated certain amount of capital, insignificant amount of capital, so that they would have an in-house corporate venture unit. That would not be a heavy burden, and that would be not a hard decision. It would be an easy decision, budget-wise. So there should not be too much of overhead, which normally we have here very high overheads, but the model should be operational. So what is a venture capitalist? I agree, there's a radical difference. Cooperative venturing is very much different from what we have in the market currently. And they are targeting different tasks. Corporate venturing is very frequently built with target of long-term sustainable growth of the corporation, so when they take decisions, which in fact should be bringing synergies. And a project today in GE, for example, you heard this term, a lean startup is coming from GE. In some of the leading business schools, they have already training courses, some about 30 business schools are teaching that already. So GE started that, and they have implemented one project on industrial batteries, a very successful project. Everybody is talking about that. What's the point of the project? Do not build a house by heavy infrastructure, but try to set up a minimal value offer that will be bought. Do not run around writing business plans looking for money. Go by small steps, very small steps. Recently, the Webson College, and there's a guy called Charles Kiffer. It's small world, actually. His son was here in Moscow, and he was my general director in my company. He was in charge of consulting. So this Charlie Kifford wrote a book, a well-known book. I was reading only the draft of that book, so the name may be different now. It's a good book for entrepreneurs, and it still has to do with lean starting. It will be published very soon in Harvard Business Review, a big article on how this lean startup works. So the main idea there is those who go and do something, they attain results. That's unlike from the companies, which is 20 years old now and as a world leader in technologies, a Russian company stays in Russia, a Russian legal entity, employs Russians, located in Leningradsky and Leninsky prospects in Moscow. So the point was they just went out and tackled that and did their job. They were not looking and waiting for something. They were not wasting their time. And more on the government contribution. Unfortunately, even being within a government program, and we do take part in developing those programs, we see this vicious circle that has been created. Lots of money is being wasted, just thrown out in the wind. Okay, this is a way to make money for the vertical integrated majors. And this is a nice looking way. There are good leaders, and they have learned, you know, to grab money from the government. They're making a plane. The plane will not fly for another 20 years. You know, but they're pumping and pumping money from the government. Because instead of setting up the demand, a competitive demand, we're financing the process of setting up products which are not in demand. So why should that money be given away for technical so-called re-equipment, technical upgrading, if the companies have purchased lots of that equipment and they don't know what to do with that? And we know this is huge amounts of money wasted. And we know the finance ministry, it's easier for them to report that, okay, money was invested in buying equipment, and this is the only reason that the money was wasted. But if the money would be wasted for a consultant, God forbid, to make a new business model, then they would be probably looking... investigators will come after you. Because equipment, you can come and see, you can touch it, okay, and everybody can have a kickback or some bribes on it. So let's be open. I'm trying to tell you how it happens in Brazil. One of our customers has penetrated the Brazilian market. Shipbuilding, vessel building. One of our clients is trying to enter the most prosperous Brazilian market of shipbuilding. So how do they stimulate innovation? How does the local government stimulate innovation, encourage innovation? First, The Petrobras company, this is like something like Gazprom in Brazil. They have no right to buy anything non-Brazilian. They declared this is their policies. How do they compete then within WTO? Very easy. They say we are not supporting our industry. No, we are setting up, we're building new Brazilian industry. In the last six, seven years, from 8,000 to 82,000 people employed in shipbuilding. All of the wharves, all of the plants are busy. And they're building brand new, entirely new class of ships because Petrobras is designating new specs, and our company is now, okay, you have to have the speed of 80 kilometers per hour with certain specs. We don't have a ship like that, but nobody has a ship like that. So Petrobras, if you build a ship like this, if you can do that, we'll buy from you. Okay, maybe that will reduce the specs a little bit, but the first fact is, you want to get an order, I pledge you can build a ship like that. And the world companies are all looking for that order now. But in order to execute that order, or get that order first, you have to come to the Brazilian market and have to come a Brazilian resident company. That was the first requirement. As soon as you're a Brazilian company, you have the access to the local financing. 20-year credit, 5% per annum, 5 years grace period, and it just takes 2 years to build the ship. So 20 years, no problem if you are a Chinese originally, or a Russian, or a Japanese. Here's the problem with WTO. The industry grows, but the only problem, okay, Brazilian ships have come to be 30% more expensive than Spanish made because there's too many strikes. They're all on strike and there's too many jobs now. So the workers will shift fast from one plant to another plant, and the engineers will get $10,000. And our engineers have already learned the Portuguese language there. Because indeed there's high demand for engineers, lack of personnel. And look, they have built the demand, actually. And the way it's adjusted is that they made up a special committee, 15 men strong committee, 8 from the industry, one of the companies, and they're always being arranged and they're rotated on a regular basis so that there's no conflict of interest. And there's the reps of 3 state banks. And they're always monitoring this budgeting of the shipbuilding and the actual customer reps. So there's always this big punching hand from the customer, because high risks, you should meet the the deadlines, you should meet the safety and security. If you have an accident, high probability your order will be dropped. Very high safety requirements. I have never seen that here in Russia. If you walk into a dock, we made some 20 visits there, and they've had us, you know, very special brief, safety brief, and then they give us the high boots, the helmets. Well, our client is buying that dock in Brazil at plant because they want to take part in that fast-growing market in the world, a very attractive market. And this is our target. This is a Russian company, and they get new possibilities. They're coming with new ideas. In fact, eventually they found an idea how to build this new ship from Brazil. They are now developing it with the designers. So this is an innovative process. Two things. Very high requirements for a competitive product, high ambitious specs by the customer. Those specs have to be met. Doors are open for everybody. Residents, non-residents, everybody's welcome. But they have to become Russian eventually, in our case. Specific order, financing with transparent budget, and nobody's financing just procurement of equipment or vague scientific research, aside from fundamentals. The fundamental or complex research that could not be, you know, given away to somebody else, like defense ministry. But okay, that should be the case. That should be the way it is. Like space, there's a lot of special classified things. But the rest should be financed like that. And then there'll be new companies springing up that could come to this market Then we'll have this innovation process. Well, I believe in the vertical majors corporate venturing. I believe this is one of the few ways, because we have no other infrastructure in place. That's what we have. Here's my colleague said, we have no other economy. He was right. We don't have any economy anymore. A company is doing the strategic planning. We were the leaders in our sector for fast-growing Russian companies. We were unconditional leaders, not the McKinsey, not anybody else. We were doing pre-feasibility studies, and et cetera. And those are $50 to $300 million size companies, and they were growing fast, aggressive. So at this strategic session, we discussed how many customers like that we had in the last 3 years. We just only had two. The Abraudyurso winery, they've grown four times after they given them their new strategy. And some other. And now we have this department store, Children's World, but it's hardly an SME. We don't have any more customers coming. Where did they go? It's not just the crisis. People have no ambition to grow anymore. Well, if those entrepreneurs have no ideas to grow, then we have a different problem. We have a very deep problem. It goes much deeper than whatever we're discussing here. If you look into the reality, and we have to support the entrepreneurs and their interest in growth. Otherwise, there'll be no innovative activities. That's first and foremost creating value for the user. So there must be a man who has brand new ideas to bring the value, how to implement it, the potential of his knowledge, or borrowed knowledge, or his own knowledge. The world is changing. We don't always see that. We sit down here behind our own fence and trying to see what's happening. Have a contest, $50,000 contest, to solve your problem. And you will have dozens of proposals from leading universities in the world how this problem should be solved. And it will be very cheap compared to what you're doing today. So the problem is not where to get ideas. The problem is how to integrate that knowledge into a ready product and bring it into the market, a final product ready for the user. So this is the main problem in Russia. We do not integrate products. It's been long since we setting our value for the user. In principle, we do not believe it is necessary. Too bad, because it's better be built in Intel Link. It's best to sit on the budget and have some free money for so-called innovation. Thank you. I may have been a little bit tough, but I thought I was right. Thank you, Alexander. A very complex vision. One of the most important sector today is the major corporations, who are partly both generators and then the users of innovation. I would ask Pavel Lykin, who is the CEO of the Ramensk machine building, instrument building plant. Let us ask him what is his vision. Thank you. That's my first time in an event like that. So my apologies for maybe for what I say is not actually very, very true. But what I'm discussing here is of great concern. And this is a core problem for our company as well. Just a few words about our company. Up to 92, just like any other company, we were leaders in our industry. We had those government decorations, etc. In 92, the country is gone. There's different ideas and targets. There was a S-type fluctuation line. But 2010, we came back to be the leader, come back to be the leader in Russia in 10 years. $140 per capita in our company, and we are monopolistic in the market of aircraft components, and we have some world records in designing components. For example, designing a new complex for the American F-18 fighter, they spent 2 years, and they said that was a world record. For the Sukhoi 27, it took us 9 months to design a new complex. So we are now capable of designing things in a very short time. But unfortunately, there's issues like discussed here. When major companies, they lose interest in the result. They are interested in just generating money and copy things that have been designed a long time ago. Secondly, there was another record of ours. If all the defense companies in the early 90s, they were not paying salaries in the early 90s. Since 93, we're paying salaries 3 times a month, day to day, on the day. Achievement number 3, we're building housing for our employees, which is critical. And we have 31% younger employees, which is very good. With Sagemo, we've first to set up a joint venture with this company in defense technologies as inertial systems for aircraft. Well, those achievements is certain foundation, yeah, but it's not the house. It's foundation that, but it's not a house that we are intending to build, because we believe that the company should be progressing with time. So the image of the company that we have now, there are many other similar companies in defense and aircraft industry, but they are not in line with current times, because they were built in older times with different visions. And I believe most of them don't have any prospects. In fact, we do not have much prospects, because we have developed a different, entirely different strategy. And I believe it's good to know that we've designed the right strategy. I believe so. As I say, 2-in-1. As I want to talk about major companies, 2-in-1. I believe there's no contradiction between majors and SMEs. They should be, you know, they should be complementing each other. Companies that have investment potential on one hand, and they are a certain umbrella for smaller companies or for individual entrepreneurs. And the SMEs or entrepreneurs or any innovative business, they can be very fast in growing. So eventually you have to build an environment in a company where you are shaping your people. So our major task is to make a socially oriented company where we are shaping people. It's not just innovations. You cannot imagine any progress today with innovation. This word has actually lost its meaning. We should be shaping people that want to be happy working in a company, working in this country, and people who bear this responsibility, let's say within a company, they should be building this environment. And on the country scale, you have to build this environment where people would be happy. Unfortunately, when we talk about innovative businesses in Russia, Friday I attended this international conference in Switzerland, and we were the organizers. We have set up this club in Switzerland. So there were some reports presented. One of those said, when the government is leading innovation, it is leading nowhere, like France. But when the government makes an environment for development, then everybody stands to gain, like USA or Israel. Well, maybe Brazil, you discussed here. So in this case, I would like everyone to be doing his own job. I agree, many people live good lives and they're getting, you know, calm and easy, but look at the roads we have, and if we go in line with that and we look at the way the businesses are developing here, we're not getting anywhere. The paradigm of thinking has to be changed, and eventually we have to change the targets, because just extrapolating based on 10-15% growth, it's not leading us anywhere. We have to change the things in principle, radically. And I believe in our company we have designed this strategy. Now we're following the way of, now looking at the development of our products. Every of the department leaders had 10-20% growth plans. We disagreed. Now we have to change this paradigm, the top management said. So we have decided to turn this company into something like Skolkovo in itself, and we believe that's a good example to be followed. But if Skolkovo builds their own startups, up to the certain level when they are ready to join the market. We're trying to follow this complete cycle growth. Because we're a design bureau, we have always been doing this. We've created two foundations, and I hope this answers your question directly. One foundation was our own completely. We use it to finance classified designs. Another one was set together with a Russian venture company that will be used for open, non-classified sites. Today, there's no direct transfer from one area to the other. It is going either way. It's actually going three ways. So after having set up those foundations, we're building a technopolis where they change the economics and the functioning of the company. So we're building an entirely different business model, the one you described. And that model, a human being is in the center, in the focus. And we're ready to invest, we're ready to improve the job conditions and provide housing. Again, first and foremost, if anybody has personal career problems, come to us, to Ramenskaya. We'll give you good conditions to grow and to implement yourself. And after that, it's all in your hands. If you want to retire or resign, it's all in your hands. You should plan your life and not wait for the government to pay you a pension the size of which is not so good. The rest of the world knows it. A man should be planning his life from the very beginning. So having set a company like this, this is a dream. If anybody wants to contribute to this dream, we're very open. We're tackling things that not many people believe in. When I invite consultants or experts, when they look in our environment, and they ask, you want to improve it even more? Yes, we say, but the first stage, when people don't believe it, don't believe in anything, when something happens, when they see improvement, then they start to believe it. And they say, this is the way it's going to happen all the time. So setting up new environment, that's the point. And it's not the point whether this man is our in-house or invited. Okay, we realize we are still short of some expertise and knowledge, but we're looking after it. So we're willing to do things, so many things. And this willingness to do things will lead to results. It will break the barriers. There are so many barriers, even more barriers being built, even on the government level. An example, there's a federal target programs are being done. I believe it's an absolute waste of money, a very low efficiency of that money. It will be much easier to build a foundation and distribute that money so that fully independent expert opinion would channel that money. But that's not the case. If there's rain, we take an umbrella. So we can influence what's happening in the government. The point is how we will react to that. So in this situation, we believe the benefit stays with the people who have trust, who believe in the future, who are working hard. And again, the crucial point is setting up conditions, the environment. Not all the people have strong will. But the capabilities are there, they have to be disclosed. We should help people to disclose their capabilities. It is not 1941-45, it is 2013. Remember those people, they won the war, they had this will. At this time, not many of us have the will. We don't criticize anybody, we would like to work and set up value. And we will have assistance. Okay, Skolkovo is an example. Well, I stay here for 10, 15 minutes, and I had a good positive charge. Another good charge I got sitting at this table and discussing, and I heard some answers. Thank you. Thank you so much. Dmitry, I understand in Krasnoyarsk there is some expertise already in working together with SMEs. Oh yes, good day. I'm actually burning a little bit, so I'm smashed, I'm crashed. I got so much impressions here, so I may be losing my line here. Again, some introductions. I understand all the terms used here. We use the terms. I do not understand that the peers is an imitation of the process. And I disagree with the term innovations not in demand. And the moderator was quite clear about that. But I fully agree with the comment of my colleagues. that you have to use the legends. Again, volume-wise, I'm losing my line a little bit. The topic was not touched yet. Skolkovo, the state, the government is trying to support the environment and innovations. We work with smaller businesses which go in parallel. Practically, in all the areas, our company is active. It is both territorial clusters. Since last autumn, we're active in all of Russia. There's financing techniques like PRs, peers. And there's technological platforms for space also, industry. In fact, there are many areas which we could be very specific about in a constructive way. My colleague is here from Talis. We can talk about that or we cannot talk about that. We have an agreement. Sorry for being direct. I agree, we all lie, and they all lie to us. But mostly in one thing. Sorry for being so rude. We do lie to each other, but in one major thing, in timelines. We would tell each other that very soon things will be good. No, that won't happen fast, because if it's not fast, then nobody is interested. Hey, Skolko, give me a result in 2 years. No. Rosnano, give me results in 4 years. No, that's not realistic. Joint production with Talis. In 1 year, you want a result? No, nothing happens in 1 year. We have a different business plan. But this is normal when it comes to human factor. Everybody wants things to happen fast. In fact, I disagree to many more things rather than agree. State support doesn't bear fruit immediately. There should be clear-cut support for territorial clusters in Europe, not only Europe, Brazil. For many decades, the government support was there, full programs, both power industries. They were using government support, all of them. And again, this Bortnik Foundation, we're working very closely together. And we have a resident in Skolkovo, a company that haven't shown any results yet, but they do tackle with complex engineering, and they will show up some results. So everywhere you need to be patient. And I prepare to be more specific, to go topic by topic and report on different areas in a more specific way.
Well, I took down what I wished to say, but this is too much for one presentation. So apologies for such a critical comment. Which I would like to make a comment, very important one, about the timelines. Well, we're roughly the same age, just give or take. So we have been for 20 years in this process, so that we are on the same page on a time. For the North Western province for 10 years. The Robert Nobby, he was sent young to the province where the miners were striking. And first the shipbuilding wharf stopped, then the metallurgy and the miners, and the joblessness was about 50%, so he visited us, and the governor asked him, did you have an issue? And he said that there were 50% joblessness, people without jobs, and Thatcher was sent him as a young person to the province, and it's very important. So he was the first to resolve the issues for 10 years. In Northwestern, he put together a strategy of development. He provided the good forecasts. He invested bankers, and they were just, you know, the wharf workers and miners. And he suggested the electronics and development. And he came to Parliament, made this presentation, and the Parliament response was just, have you seen those miners? Have you looked at the faces? How can you make them just... And he came back, and then they opened the representing offices in Japan and US. 5 years later, they developed several plants, Nissan, and in 7 years, there were about 100, and Siemens invested into the chips. So the province became absolutely different. So when our people started talking about the timelines, his response was, if I saw such people as Tomsk, I would revolve the earth. So just, you know, if we think about 10 years, next generation will be just, you know, people without any financial support. You can do over 1 year so many things. Look at the very short time. Finland, for instance, my example. I know the person, he's a friend of mine who developed the strategy of development of Finland. Everybody was laughing at him when they planned to become a leader in telecommunication. There was a Nokia, only small company. I know the person who was behind that, and they told me how they did that. And they said, just let's sell the chemical business, our tires, and invest everything into telecommunications. They didn't have anything. Pursue the government to invest into the education, just into the education, because this is the most critical thing. What Minister of Industry of Korea told me, he told me that when we were thinking where to go, we were at the verge of capitalism, but the main issue for us was if we fail, what our children will have. So let's invest into the education. The children will be more wise, and they will change the things in the country. So very banal and straightforward approach. In our country, there's a conflict of generations. The young people cannot come and become just, you know, responsible, and we. Elder people, let's be frank, over 20 years we could have ended up with a flourishing company, a country much better than we have having today, with the base that we started. And I was among the 10 best scientists in USSR. You remember they were just selected 10 best scientists, and I was quite ambitious. So we lost 20 years. If we think about next 50 years, nothing will happen. And I would like to reiterate that it was absolutely correct. Mentioned that the new generation of people should be involved, and we should set up good conditions for them who will be more rational, more wise, more thoughtful than we who lost the chance. Well, 20 years, nothing happened in Russia. This is a very wrong comment. People who are thinking and talking, the average, well, at the main floor, they were just, you know, 20 years ago, they were school children. So I disagree that we lost this 20 years, two decades in Russia from the joblessness, the statistics in Russia, you know. I can tell you about Tula. We have two. Joblessness is less than 1%. The average number of Europe, this is not a 1 or 10 or 15%, not even 20%. This is about 25%. So we are, this is our topic about the efficiency of labor. But you cannot say that everything was bad for 20 years in Russia. Well, colleagues, we have our own opinion. I had different ambitions. You have one set of missions. I had my ambitions. And I'm sitting at the meetings of the Global Competition Forum, and the Korean representative just developed the rating of the best medium and weekly developed. Russia is sitting in the third, and I'm sitting in cross of him, and he's seeing my reaction to that. And you're second from the last. Well, he said the three fundamental advantages. We Koreans came to the this perception of the idea. The competition boils down to natural resources, the size of the domestic market, and the human capital. Unfortunately, we as Korea and Singapore don't have the long-term perspective because the global market becoming competitive and we have difficult to grow their domestic market. We cannot grow as we cannot increase the efficiency. We're at the top level and everybody's coming to me and thinking, what goes on in Russia? You have all these advantages. And he turned the page and showed the graph showing four factors, the parliament, the government, the management quality, the quality of professionals, engineers, designers, scientists, and the quality of the workforce. We have everything available to be 10 times better, but we have different set of ambitions. I think we can do better. We can. We have the experience, and I decided to stay away from mentioning my company. And in my company, the efficiency is the highest in Russia among the all Russian companies. This is $300,000 a person a year. My company occupies the third position in the global development market. In not a single country, there's company which came to McKinsey, BCG, and we will be better because we are providing the best services and we are selling without just paying kickbacks, even in Russia. So can we do it? So if we can succeed, why others don't? So you're the only company that, well, we're not the only. I'm not, this is not my... well, we can do 10 times more, and I gave you the, well, can we just came to the ground? I just don't want to leave this talk without any specificity. Speaking of the territorial clusters, Dmitry said the right thing. You know that in mission industry, the support was provided in St. Petersburg. How much money was allocated in St. Petersburg to support mission industry companies? 7.8 million rubles. On at another side, the director of the boarding fund, Polyakov, should have been giving address. How much money was given to the boarding for to dealing with the mission industry? 27 million for the whole country. Shall we address and just open the 10-6 line item for mission industry, or let's write a letter to the governor of St. Petersburg to increase by a factor of 10 the funding for the mission industry of transportation? Well, I didn't bring, well, I wasn't prepared to this talking. We looked through the budget documentation recently, and I'm a deputy to the parliament, and this is my job. So the lowest obedience with the budget, this is the line item with the support of the business. When you're saying that 27 million are allocated with the machine industry, what sums were allocated and what sums were given? The Rosnana is a small funding. This funding for regional is low because the activity of the companies, which should be discussed here. So this is why we're setting up the forum in Siberia, the active position like yours. It's not quite more big sums for Skolkova. Your involvement is important. I think that you have several bottlenecks in engineering, which you can implement while addressing the issues of Roscosmos. This is the issue of being active, being proactive on a human level. We are dealing much with the education, and we have been sitting in Russia for 15, 20 years, managers, financials. Now the education system is trying to get back to just produce engineers, but with a wider scope, because just, you know, I'm seeing the engineers, good engineer is not necessarily a good manager and financial person. And engineers should be thinking about the financial effect. This is a very difficult issue. So in our city, the program for supporting engineers and innovation studies was the lowest. Well, we decided to give floor to energy company. I would like to support. Now there's a program setting up to support the innovation projects in Russia, and 17 million. There's a four municipality applied, and there won't be a competition. There will be just, you know, the filling the requests. So we are ready to this counter current from the business. We are willing to respond. Without this two-way street, we won't resolve anything. There shouldn't be just one-way street. There should be just, you know, some feedback. And this mechanism is being formed now. So you would like to get this feedback, right? Well, I recently I heard the number, just, you know, the amount of details in iRobus, which was installed on iRobus between 55% and 60%. So why? 30 years ago, the iRobus started producing. So let's. We are selling to the value of about $1 billion, and the share of our own work is about 30%. So to maintain that the 5% is a big corporation is just not realistic. For 60 years, the industry exists, and from the legal standpoint, we have areas where the input of SME is pretty high. We are not analyzing our corporation, but we have about 600 companies with which we work. And we don't know to what class they belong, to small, medium business. So this is an indication of the healthy business. So the business is straightening up, and the business is, if business is producing something, it's a healthy business. Can you tell us about energy? I think everybody knows about the energy, the Russian aerospace corporation. I wouldn't mention much. Much information is provided at the websites. Well, I would like to touch on the issue which we are discussing now, without downsizing the advantages of the Skolko as a site to generate startups. I would like to mention the following. This goes on in the context of Alexei Borisovich mentioned. The process should be harmonized from the very beginning to the end. Just, you know, from the inception up to the sale of the ready products. And from this standpoint, all the chains, all the steps of the process should play their own role, potentially in their multiplicity to resolve the final issue. As for the corporate venture funds, I think they have the right to leave, especially accounting for what Bulat said. About the necessity of experimental base, the product of the aerospace industry are high-tech, research-intensive from the R&D standpoint. I doubt that in Skolkovo, the test production line will be developed to manufacture what is needed for aerospace industry. I think it will be justified to involve the experience and competences of the big industry which exists. From this standpoint, the corporate venturing can play its role. Speaking of the venture funding at all, I think this is a separate topic. Why the success is not big in our industry to set up this process? There's a long term of development, the high risks, research and developments, and the business is ready to take these risks. But at the same time there should be a position of the government provided. The government should do similar to what Americans do, to guarantee that the services will be bought if the services are of required quality and at the price which is agreed. And I think there should be some benefits spread over this process as well, the same that are provided for Skolkovo. And I think that when all the chains of the process are streamlined, the process will start working. Thank you very much. Colleagues, I would like to take some time from the next session and ask our guest to share with us the vision with the business on SME with Vedas and Talas Allen.
The role in EDES Russia here.
Yes, thank you very much indeed for the opportunity to speak here. I shan't be too long, so I'll try and focus in on the points that I think are most relevant. First of all, who is EADS? Well, EADS is the parent company of Airbus, civil aircraft manufacturer, also Eurocopter, helicopter manufacturer.
Мы все понимаем как по-английски, или нам нужно как-то с переводом как решить вопрос? Давайте, может быть, как-то мы их асинхронно будем. Сейчас, сейчас, вот можно взять как наушники, кому нужно, вот там, секунду, just a second, please. Там вот лежат синхронные наушники, то есть кому-то они нужны, можно их взять очень быстро.
Okay. Continue, please. Great. Well, once again, thank you very much indeed for the opportunity to speak here. I represent the company EADS, which is the parent company of Airbus, manufacturer of civil aircraft, Eurocopter, helicopters, Astrium Space, and also Cassidian, which is involved in communications, amongst other things. First of all, the importance of SMEs. To EADS. We see SMEs as being really technology incubators. And the European view is that that's really where the jobs are. The big organizations, the big companies, are very good, well adapted, at maintaining and sustaining existing markets. By their very nature, they tend to be comparatively low-risk organizations because there's too much risk at stake if they make a mistake. On the other hand, SMEs, by their very nature, are high risk. Usually the people working together in the SME have staked everything they have on their venture. So they're very good at creating new markets, searching for those new markets. Therefore, the two organizations, the two types of organizations, are complementary. Big and small. But because you have big and small, you have an incompatibility. And that shows up particularly when you look at the purchasing policy, procurement policy of large companies like Airbus or Boeing or Bombardier, because those companies only want to work with similar-sized organizations, what we term tier one suppliers. So in the USA, there's a company called Spirit. In France, we have Latécoère, Safran. Thank you very much, tier one supplier. GKN in the UK, and a number of others. Alenia, sometimes in Italy. So where do the SMEs fit in? Because they're far from being tier one suppliers. And that's a problem because the procurement organizations say, we're not interested, they're not big enough. And yet, if we say that's where the jobs are and also that's where the technology is, we have to find a place for them. What we have found is that we companies like EADS in Europe can use research projects as a way of bringing the small companies into partnerships with the tiers of the supply chain and the OEM, the final integrator of the product. So that means you create a supply chain for the purposes of the project, where all of the parties are acting as equals. So that gives the SME the opportunity to actually feed through their technology to the final product via the other layers of the supply chain. So we've seen some very good examples of that. The government governments do have a role to play, because government grants can actually help those project teams to form. It's an attraction to all parties. One of the other areas in which we've brought, or one of the other means we've used to bring SMEs into contact with other suppliers and also the OEMs, is via the technology parks that we see springing up around Europe, where you have, for example, I'm thinking of the composites one in Nantes in France, or there's also one in the UK, and there's one in Germany. So you have a number of small companies working with larger companies, not just dedicated to one particular product, but maybe aircraft, boats, wind turbines. So the companies there are working together. It gives the SME exposure to the larger organizations, and therefore a market opportunity. And the other point is that there's hardware there. And I think one of the other speakers raised the point that it's easier to put together an IT company because you don't need hardware. The moment you need hardware, that represents a big investment, it's a big commitment, and it's often out of the scale of the SME's budget. And that made me think about an example that I was involved in some 18 years ago, where we created a startup by accident in the Republic of Ireland. The Republic of Ireland isn't noted for its aerospace technology, or indeed its composites technology. But we worked with a very adventurous team in a university in Galway, in the west of the Republic of Ireland. We worked on a project that was partly funded by the Irish government, and Airbus UK, the company I was working for, was interested in some technology they had. Actually, the project was a complete disaster. The technology didn't work, but we liked the team a lot. They were clearly capable of many good things, and in order to try and make the project work in the first place, we actually had to invest in some hardware. So we created a test facility, in fact, which was capable of testing to civil aircraft standards in the west of Ireland, in a university. And what happened was that the team, after the project had finished, came to us again and said, well, look, you know, you've invested in this hardware, together with government money, can't we use it for something else? So we looked for opportunities, and we said, okay, well, it's testing hardware. Let's see if we can find some testing contracts for you. So the testing contracts became prototyping contracts and ultimately became series production contracts. So now, 18 years later, they're actually quite a significant supplier to both Rolls-Royce, Dassault, Bombardier, Airbus, and also the wind turbine industry. And really the message there was that you have to have enthusiasm, at least on the part of the SME. You have to be extremely determined. But what's also clear is that on the part of the larger company, the EADS, the Airbus of this world, you have to have receptive people. Because if the answer is no, we're not interested, you're too small, nothing happens. In Russia, we've actually had some very good experiences. EADS, Airbus have been performing research in conjunction with research institutes here in Russia for more or less 20 years. Some projects are more successful than others, naturally. And some of them are very successful. And you'll find the results on the A380 and soon to fly on the A350 Airbus aircraft as well. So what we started with was a more or less running research contracts in Russia from our headquarters in Toulouse. So my predecessor started that and I took over. But it's clearly you're limited in what you can do from a distance. So we set up a relationship with an institute here in Russia, which became our sort of preferred supplier, if you like, and then they program managed other organizations. And then when the Skolkovo Foundation was created, we said, well, okay, this is the opportunity now to turn that relationship with the Russian Institute into a real company. So we did that. And we have another spin-off called Data Advance, which is which produces simulation modeling software, and we're actively using that to support the design of aircraft. So again, dedicated team. The business has actually come out of a series of projects that were successful and progressed over a period of time, so we maintained the funding over a period of time, and now it's to the point where they're selling their services to a wider market. Third spin-off, it's actually one that we've, a startup company that we've taken a shareholding in recently called Telum, which is concerned with communication software protocols. So we've created two spin-offs in Russia, and we've invested in a third. We're looking to do more, actually. I don't know much about GE's startup venture capital system, but certainly EADS has its own investment mechanism. So we can tap into that when we see that an SME is offering some technology that is not actually necessarily directly related to our core. In fact, it shouldn't be. It should extend our business into a different market that we haven't been able to explore properly ourselves. So bridging the link between the small SME, which has the technology, and the large organization. And that financial mechanism helps perform the integration. So in summary, let's say SMEs are clearly very, very important. Large companies have a responsibility to encourage SMEs. Otherwise, it's extremely difficult to make any progress. The example I gave you in Ireland happened by accident. But thanks to that accident, I understand a bit more about how things can work. And we are looking for opportunities in Russia. And the Skolkovo Foundation, frankly, is a fantastic opportunity as we see it for supporting international cooperation as well as helping the Russian economy to evolve. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Sounds quite an experience, and thank you especially for.
Спасибо большое за теплые. Thank you very much. Now we will ask Ashot Abakunt, the representative of Thales Aerospace in Russia. Thank you very much for inviting me to this event, and that was a very interesting discussion. I will not repeat, because I agree to many of the things voiced here. But one generalization, maybe, to what we heard here. Judging on the world's development, latest developments, successful things or explosive developments or technologies breakthrough, innovation breakthrough, they happen when there's at least three prerequisites in place. First, you have to have an idea, a big idea, on the level of a nation, on the level of a state. Secondly, then there should be scientific potential in place, because all the things that have to do with startups or major companies, they all are based on a product being sold, that product was created by scientific potential. So there's a certain environment that has to be in place for those things to happen. In fact, this is it. I believe those three factors should be there, available for any breakthroughs. So what's happening in Skolkovo now, it's very good, but it's a small island in a sea. So this expertise has to be scaled up outside of Skolkovo. Thank you, Ashot. I will pass the mic now to Alexander Borisovich for a conclusive phrase. Well, I would like to be not so pessimistic, because my colleagues may have the impression that I'm depressive. No, I'm not. You may have heard, I do believe in corporate venturing, and we have cooperated with many companies. And I'm part of this Strategic Committee of the Rostechnologie, Russian Technology, and despite of all the negative image of the Rostechnologie group, we do find a lot of interesting ideas within that company. Okay, they are a restructuring company. They are not actually innovators. They are restructurers. They're trying to bring some order into the group of 100 companies that they were actually shoved with, that they were dumped on them. But this progress, they are in the process of being set up and restructured. There's great potential, and I'm not saying there's nothing in place. I was just, my point was that we could have been much farther ahead. So many companies could have advanced farther if the venturing was there earlier in place, with only a fraction of the capital needed. Another point, you have to do it in the right way. There's experiences, international and domestic, to be followed. There are failures to be watched. There are plenty of failures to be analyzed. So it is very hard to, you should not go into very, very risky things, because too much diversification could be pointless, senseless. So bigger corporations, they are not venture foundations. But again, there are big prospects, including lots of jobs. That's exactly where new jobs could be coming from. There's new emergencies, new people, new economics. So I'm sure that this will happen. We should be pragmatic, and we're looking far ahead. This will happen. Yeah, we will not disappear as a country. Thank you. Will there be any discussions? No, but we are entering the next stage now. The Higher School of Economics here, the Airspace Foresight of Russia. With due respect, you will have 2 minutes. Just out of respect for you. Ivan Kubarev, a couple of minutes only. Dear colleagues, our cluster must have united two major areas. This is space and nuclear energy. But we didn't mention any nuclear energy. Those are this connection has to do with longer distance flights to Mars or the Moon using jet engines. But this was not covered or mentioned here today, even though this should incorporate the older and the latest developments and designs. This has to be paid attention to. In the last 10 years, they were talking about this on the prime minister and presidential level. But unfortunately, currently, as far as I know, and I'm within that industry, I've been there for quite a while. And I'm an author of one registered scientific discovery, and I have contributed to some of the space flights. I've found explanations for the loss of some of the spacecraft. I have a small team now under me, just 4 or 5 winners of a state prizes, but we are poor, relatively poor, and we have been applying here and there, but our views are not fully in line with the Roscosmos functionaries. So I would ask to go into that, and to the attitudes towards space should be very serious. There were good speeches here on how to expand and how to implement developments and designs, but they have to be developed and designed first. And I believe that was not covered properly here. Thank you. If anybody wants to talk to me, you're welcome. Thank you, Yuri Vasilievich.